walking along the street, or you're at a party, or else you're alone, and then you suddenly dig. You're looking in someone's eyes, you suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big.
I've had a blast diving into the history of game shows across this channel, and the genre continues to utterly fascinate me. Game shows dominated the TV airwaves for the better part of the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s. These shows were light, fluffy, and provide an interesting and topical snapshot of their respective periods, and to make matters even more delightful, tons of them are available on YouTube. The first years of game shows are iconic, but are largely defined by a few members of a legendary boys' club when looking at the history of the genre. However, in the first two decades of televised game shows, there were a number of fierce and legendary women who made their names and careers in the industry. They were interesting, vibrant, and they all had fascinating stories in their own right. So, this isn't discounting the fabulous and colorful names and personalities of the 1970s game shows, but this list will be looking at the iconic women working in the shows of the 50s and 60s. So, here we go with the top five women of the classic era of game shows. Betty White is a name still popular and well-known to contemporary audiences, thanks to her legendary work on television and shows like Golden Girls, The Mary Tyler Moore Show, and Hot in Cleveland. Her iconic status was cemented by the 1970s, but White was working prolifically throughout the 1940s and 1950s. In fact, in a televised interview, she mentioned appearing in a broadcast at the 1939 World's Fair, which is known as the debut of television really as a thing. During the first two decades of television, Betty White helmed a handful of series, namely Life with Elizabeth and Date with the Angels, and she begins to pop up in game shows during this period. Here she is in 1955 on the panel of What's My Line?
Oh, Bean, you know, this isn't at all fair at home. I never know why you don't guess this easier. You have it written right across the contestant right here, and it's a cinch to know what it is. Is this a large object, this product that you are associated with?
Sometimes.
Does this product, is it used by both men and women?
Yes.
Am I right in assuming it's used equally by men and women?
Yes. Certainly it could be, yes.
Is it, an object small enough for me to hold in my hand?
Yes.
Sometimes.
Yes. Sometimes.
Would I be likely to hold it in my hand?
I think you'd better take the dive and say no. Don't you think so?
I think it would be no. Three down and seven to go, Mr. Sir.
As the 1950s turned into the 1960s, she became a mainstay on television screens, branching off into a plethora of shows which filled the airways.
Betty?
Thank you, Bud. Number three, who came in second in the 100 meters?
Dorothy Hammond.
Number two, where was your home originally?
Clarksville, Tennessee.
And number one, when did you first start to run?
In high school in Clarksville.
Number three, how many hours a day do you still run?
2 hours a day.
Number two, in Clarksville, what is the main street?
There's Kellogg Street.
Her association with game shows gets cuter and more permanently solidified when she married presenter and host Alan Ludden in 1963.
Panel, in this case, one question at a time, in turn, moving clockwise.
Is the password marriage? Alan Ludden and Betty White.
Until very, very recently, Betty White and Alan Ludden, and happily now, Mr. and Mrs. Alan Ludden. And congratulations to you both.
Did you know that I had trouble
finding it? She did it, Arlene. She did it.
And you were going to let me know. You forgot. You were so excited that she said yes.
He was going to let me know.
I told you. I don't know. Didn't I tell you?
No, you forgot. You said you would. But anyway, I'm so glad it happened. I don't care if you'd kept it a secret from me.
Just for fun, did you hear what happened when you asked if you had a regular television program? And Alan what? Hollered yes, and Betty hollered no. At the same time. Alan's password at 10 o'clock. It's one of the most regular, I guess. What is it, 10 o'clock every Monday night and every afternoon at 3, 5 days
two.
A week? Two. Every afternoon at 2.
Betty's on tomorrow night.
Oh, good. Yes.
With Jack
Wonderful.
Clark.
So that's fine.
You gotta temper a few answers to her, Alan?
No. No!
I thought you were Ed Wynn when you first came in.
Oh, well, thank you.
We all, with all our hearts, wish you great happiness and a wonderful world in the future.
Alan Ludden is known as a game show host of the era, and most specifically for the long-running series Password.
Alan?
What are your plans for the summer, Betty?
Well, I'm going to do some... What did you have in mind, Alan? I'm going to do some summer theater with my husband, Alan.
Where, Betty?
Alan and I are going to do, Alan Ludden, that is,
uh-huh.
on Password, are going to do Brigadoon in Paterson, New Jersey, and then we're going to do, I go to St. Louis, we're going to have a big fight, and then I go to St. Louis and do King and I, then we make up, and Alan and I are going to get back together again in Janus, Dennis and Skowhegan.
Gee, I hope I can see it. Nice to have you here. It's a very great deal to have Betty here.
The reunion was a source of many jokes throughout White's long-running career appearances until he passed away in 1981. Betty White continues to be a queen, is 98 years old, and is still actively working. Kitty Carlisle is a name which is perhaps not the most well-known to contemporary audiences. A legitimately trained opera singer, her career started in New York before she moved to Hollywood in the 1930s to headline musicals like Murder at the Vanities. However, she's best remembered for her role in the 1935 Marx Brothers comedy, A Night at the Opera. She worked primarily in theater throughout the following decades, though understandable as musicals strayed far away from the operetta-based musicals of the 1930s. With the explosion of television in the 1950s, Carlisle found a new home as a game show panelist. A scan through her filmography shows her popping up in a number of different shows.
You perform your services in the entertainment world.
Right.
Do you perform them in what you might loosely call a theater? Such as an order. Let me phrase it differently. John, wait a minute.
I haven't said a word.
I'm afraid of you.
I haven't said a word.
Would you perform it in a large auditorium, sort of?
Yes.
Would this auditorium be something that could house a great deal of entertainment, a great many people?
Right.
Would it also house animals?
Could. Yes, it could.
Would it be something like Madison Square Garden?
Yes.
Would you have anything to do with the circus?
Yes. Ooh.
The circus is coming.
On April 3rd, as a matter of fact. The circus is coming on April 3rd to Madison Square Garden. That's
Are one. You a performer in the circus?
That's right.
Do you do something other than on the ground?
Yes.
Do you perform in an aerial way?
Yes.
I think we could say he performs in an aerial way.
Are you shot out of a cannon?
Yes.
Oh, no! Oh, no! I don't believe it. Oh, no!
Oh. She became best known for her long-running role as a panelist on To Tell the Truth, which began in 1956 and ran in its original form until 1968.
Kitty.
Number three, did Paderewski ever hold a political position in Poland?
Oh, yes.
Will you tell me what it was?
It was the premier.
Number two, who is Gomulka?
He's the secretary of the party.
Number one, when you took your wife and family on vacation, so-called, to Vienna, was it a dangerous trip?
It was.
Number two, how did you make this trip?
With train.
By train. Number three, were you stopped by anyone en route?
No.
And you were given asylum immediately?
In effect.
I'm sorry?
In effect.
In effect. Number one, who did you see in the American embassy in Vienna?
I saw the military attaché and his assistant.
Number two, did you see the ambassador?
No, I saw Tom Poston.
She continued working heavily on television in the following decades until her death in 2007 at the age of 96. Bess Meyerson is one of the most diverse names on our list, with her Wikipedia page calling her an actress, a model, and a politician. Bess Meyerson broke out on television in the late 1940s after making a national name for herself when she was crowned Miss America in 1945. She holds the distinction of being the first and only Jewish woman to win the title. This came at a very important time, as World War II was ending and the subject of anti-Semitism was a major one in popular culture. Unfortunately, Meyerson's reign showed that the war hadn't cured anti-Semitism. NPR writes in her obituary that not only was she pressured to change her name, but pageant sponsors and normal opportunities dried up after she won. Meyerson appeared as a regular panelist on the long-running series I've Got a Secret, which ran from 1952 until 1967 in its original form.
All right, now, Henry and Bill, we will no longer keep you in suspense. Betsy Palmer and Bess Meyerson have prepared a little surprise for you and for the rest of our audience, too. They have spent the past few days practicing the piano so that they could join forces tonight with our special guest, Liberace. So here, then, on three pianos are the 10 magic fingers of Liberace, assisted by the 20 thumbs of Betsy Palmer and Bess Meyerson, playing, we hope, variations on a well-known theme.
Across television and a number of other shows of the period.
My first 10 questions.
Well, then I must assume that you are on Uncle Milty's show, is that right?
Yes.
And are you a regular part of the show? Are you on every week?
Yes.
Do you do comedy with him?
Yes.
They have television in Copenhagen, don't they? Sure.
Yeah.
You know.
Sure. Go on, Beth. 7 questions.
Well, is
couldn't
he...
Couldn't be Jack LaSchooley, I know that. But he's a serious actor. He's a tragedian, I would say.
Is he a very fine gentleman with an excellent sense of humor?
Well, he's got an excellent sense of humor.
He's a fine gentleman.
All right. 6
is
questions.
Is it... are you Arnold Stang?
Arnold yes. Stang is right.
As the 1960s turned to the 1970s, Meyerson got involved in politics when, according to NPR, New York Mayor John Lindsay appointed her Commissioner of Consumer Affairs.
April 15th, we all sent in our tax dollars. Here, we said to our administration, spend it wisely for me. Go to the market and purchase what I need to make my life better. But we didn't give them a marketing list. So those busy little budgeters put their heads together, and here we go again. 65 cents out of every dollar for Pentagon products. 65 cents out of every dollar for war, past, present, and future. 65 cents out of every dollar for death and destruction. I saw the budget. Do you know that it now costs $18 million a year to service and maintain our military cemeteries?
Her career in city politics continued into the 1980s when she lost the Democratic nomination for the state Senate race in an election which would be eventually won by well-known New York figure Alphonse D'Amato. Though in a painful and still all too timely bit of criticism, her New York Times obituary quotes one of her campaign advisors in saying that voters saw Meyerson as too glamorous for the Senate, despite her 35 years of public service. In the late 1980s, her career was enveloped in scandal when she was indicted on corruption charges by then Attorney General Rudolph Giuliani. The indictment stemmed from rumors that she used her position to get support payments to her then boyfriend's estranged ex cut. She was acquitted in 1988, but her career was effectively ended. Meyerson passed away in 2015 at the age of 90. The next two were a knockdown, drag-out fight for number one. So here we go. The power of What's My Line can't be denied in popular culture. The ultra-popular game show premiered in 1949 and ran in its original form deep into the 1960s. Besides host John Daly, one of the few pieces to continue with the show through some early growing pains was journalist and society columnist Dorothy Kilgallen.
$5 to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Now, you said it was ominous, but not dangerous.
No, I said that in the connotation of my answer to you, that it had an ominous connotation, but not for you.
Try again, in your native tongue this time. All right, then. Is the product with which Mrs. Scarfe is identified larger than a glass of water?
Yes.
Is it smaller than a house?
Yes.
Is it larger than a phone booth?
No.
No.
Born into a newspaper family, Kilgallen leapt into public consciousness in 1936 when, as a writer for the New York Journal American, she was sent around the world on a round-the-world flight competition against other reporters. She finished second, according to her New York Times obituary, taking 24 days for the massive journey. It wasn't long after this that she started her Voice of Broadway column, which would quickly become syndicated into popularity, and she was still writing this during her time on What's My Line. While Kilgallen is primarily seen as a society reporter, she maintains quite a bit of her initial interest as a crime reporter. Notably, she covered the controversial murder trial of Sam Shepard in 1954 and later the Kennedy assassination. I'll be shying away from this a bit as the line between fact and conspiracy theory quickly becomes blurred. If this is of interest to you, there's some fascinating reading, though it's equally as frustrating as this does obscure the name and story of this talented and accomplished woman into a bit of a complicated haze. Kilgallen appeared on What's My Line from the show's debut until her premature death in 1965. Her reputation can become a bit prickly sometimes, and it's sometimes hard to get through her shell in the rather buttoned-up game show. However, despite everything surrounding her, Dorothy Kilgallen had a fascinating story, and she broke ground in areas which women largely shied away from in the first half of the 20th century, and she didn't step back from her earlier passions. Sticking with the What's My Line trend, I knew I had to talk about Arlene Francis. I wasn't sure if Miss Francis or Miss Kilgallen would secure the number one spot, but the answer quickly became clear. More on this later. Arlene Francis debuted shortly into the run of What's My Line in 1950, and she continued with the series throughout the end of the regular run before rejoining the show for a later run in syndication. All in all, she stayed with the show for a massive 25 years.
And now, let's meet our award-winning What's My Line panel. First, the delightful star of stage and television, Miss Arlene Francis.
Now, two of America's favorite sons that we always vote for, Paul Winchell and Jerry Mahoney.
Oh, hello, dear.
Hello, how are you, Nye?
Oh, it's
so good to see you again.
It's good to hold your hand.
Oh, you look adorable. Really, you do.
I do?
Come with me to the Casbah. Jesus, you really look good.
All right, now, we have to introduce Dorothy.
You really do look good.
Well, I just jumped into this dress. Nothing?
You almost missed, you know.
However, like the women above, Arlene Francis was more than simply a panelist. She's widely considered to be the first woman to host a game show. She hosted a series called Blind Date, which is a radio dating game show throughout the 1940s, before then taking the show to television in 1949, where she top-lined it until 1952.
Bruin, the precision watch, on behalf of its thousands of Bruin jewelers all over America, brings you Blind Date, America's most romantic program, starring lovely Arlene Francis.
To hear all that enthusiasm, and my beautiful Gruen precision watch tells me it's time. Time for boy to meet girl, time for boy to date girl. And we're very happy indeed to have you on hand for our blind dating. Well, tonight is Father's Night on Blind Date. The fathers are going to speak for the boys, fathers are going to speak for the girls. And remember, they haven't seen each other before or talked to each other. It's all going to happen right before your very eyes. And so let's see now whether the fathers can do as well as their children.
A look through Francis's filmography showed her working prolifically during the 50s and 60s, including guest host spots on shows like The Price is Right and The Tonight Show.
The Price is Right, presented by new Stripe toothpaste with germ-killing hexachloroplatin for the double protection of toothpaste plus mouthwash. And now your hostess on The Price is Right, here she is, Arlene Francis.
To The Price is Right. Well, Bill Cullen is still on vacation, and I am still working, and so everything's in its proper place.
In an era where women were often relegated to a specific role, Arlene Francis was a woman who stepped out as a presenter, as a broadcaster, and as an actress, establishing herself as a mainstay on television. She was a long-running panelist and the first woman to host a game show, solidifying her spot as number one on this list. As I've launched myself into the research of the early era of televised game shows, it's fascinating to look at the host of women who came up through the industry during this time. As I've mentioned in countless videos before, it is so easy to define a personality solely and completely through a game show lens. However, the women on this list show the women on television during this time were fierce, they were intelligent, and they brought a serious talent and fascinating stories with them to the screen. Stay tuned for more here at Female Gaze Productions as we look at classic popular culture through a historical and feminist lens. My name is Kim. You can find us on Twitter at KPierce624 and at GazeFemale, G-A-Z-E female. And as always, if you like what you're seeing, please like and subscribe. Thanks, guys.